That's why we're here.
Sorry, yeah, it was working.
I just wanted to say, I think this is great that Gary volunteered to do this, and I am going to have applications back here. I don't know if I haven't joined in the past or if I want to pay dues. And after we're all done, we'll have, I guess, some refreshments there, so.
No, and I'll be glad to look at your house.
I'll let Gary take over and proceed.
Okay.
I'm glad you all came out, thank you. I'm looking forward to it very much. About 25 years ago, I went out to a Andover Historical Society workshop given by an archivist, a professional archivist for the Connecticut Historical Society. And of course, you know, internet was just barely beginning. Most people weren't digitizing anything, they didn't have camera phones. Her message was, preserve everything you got in acid-free paper. That was the message. And I did that. I preserved everything I had, precious little though it was. Newspaper clippings of family, photographs of family, drawings, whatever, in acid-free paper. And I actually did, the other thing she suggested was to put all of those carefully preserved items in acid-free paper in a fireproof safe. Did all of that. And then after 20 years of collecting and preserving, my mom died in 2011, and I cleaned out her house and her barn, where she had lived for over 50 years. And my sister and I found all sorts of things in the barn, boxes and boxes of things that we had never seen before, and that were not labeled. And that's how this began. That was 2011. It's been almost 5 years since I started this. And I realize now that I've learned a great deal, and I want to pass it on. My message is going to be digitize, digitize, and share, share. The big difference between 20 years ago and now is that back then, whatever box there was of unique items could be handed down to one descendant. Maybe the executor of the estate, maybe the eldest daughter, whoever, but only one person could really have it, unless you Xeroxed everything painfully. But now we can digitize everything and share things instantly, just with an email scan, with people who are very far away. And this is it's like a revolution, I think, in family information sharing. So that's what I've been working about, how to just first do the scans, and then how to share them. Working on this for 5 years. And I'm going to focus on the era of photographs. Some of us have family members, you know, in the boxes that go back to daguerreotypes, or even earlier, portrait miniatures, things like that, drawings, from before 1860. But I'm going to focus today just on the photographic era, which began in 1860, the year before the Civil War broke out. It's for me, and probably for many of you, that's the generation of my great-great-grandparents. They were born in the 30s or 40s, and by 1860, they were all but one or two couples were married and raising their children. But they were in their youthful prime. They were like in their 20s. And this is when they wanted to get their photos taken. And it became affordable. The daguerreotype era from 1840 to 1860 allowed people to get one-off portraits of themselves made, but they were quite expensive. Many people could not afford that. Pretty much everybody could afford a photo now and then, even if it was only once a year in their best outfit for the year. And so many of us have these photos, going back to 1860, if our families have kept them. In my family, and I will be using my family because they're the people I have access to, and the people I have been interrogating for 5 years. In my family, of my 16 great-great-grandparents, 12 were Yankees. They had been here since 1630. Their families had been. One was an English immigrant who had arrived with his parents in about 1839. And three were Irish, who had arrived in the 40s during the potato famine time. So I got three quarters Yankees and about, you know, three Irish and one English that arrived. arrive later. So let's begin. Can everybody see this if I stand here?
Yeah.
Very good. What you're going to find in a box that you may have inherited or found when your parents left the house, framed photos, framed all these things. It's going to be a mishmash. It's going to look like a mess in the box because no two things are the same size. They're all in different sizes. Some are skinny, some are fat, some are in glass, some are not, some are in leather cases. It's a mess. And one of the, why don't we turn off the lights so we can see? I have never given this talk before, so you are my guinea pigs. Thank you.
That's the lights on the sidewalk.
Is everything good and better now?
Yeah.
Okay. What to do first? Well, you're going to find some things are clumped. They're like a bundle of letters. You keep them clumped, but one by one, you scan them front and back. And be sure to do everything in the back, too. And put the originals in a safe place and work with the scans from then on. Here's an example of a photo that I, in fact, did not find in my mother's box. It came to me in an email from a cousin on the West Coast. But it was labeled on the back by, according to who did the photography, so-and-so Dawson, R.W. Dawson, photographer, Elgin, Illinois. Over the G.M. Adams jewelry store. Negatives can be reproduced at any time, it says. And here's this lovely young lady. And someone has handwritten, and I know who it is, it's my second cousin Rosamond. This is one of her aunts from Windsor, Connecticut. Which one? Libby. That's the only clue I have, Libby. But she says she's from Windsor, Connecticut. And the back of the photo card says Elgin, Illinois. So that's interesting. So once you scan something, you have to caption it. And you can do this in your photo program. Just put a caption on the bottom that says whatever you know about it. And then file each one according to where you got it. You know, if this is a box of your mother's family stuff, put it in with mother's family. If it's from father's box, make some kind of a folder that reflects where it came from. And then print out the images on 8.5 by 11 paper. This is so easy. You just press print and you get a picture like that. You can do the front and the back and create much larger images than what you usually start with. And the lovely thing is, not only are they bigger than many of the originals, they're all the same. They're all uniform. Here's our lady here, Libby, blown up. The original is tiny. And it's very, very nice to have them in 8.5 by 11 size for looking.
I'm just wondering, what resolution do you scan on?
800 dpi, does that sound right? 600? Yeah, 600. It's sort of the default. I may have said it years ago, but I haven't thought about it since. So you caption. And then if you have any information, you just make sure that you include the information you have with each image. Okay. Now you've got a store of images. Maybe you've printed them all out, and you have a three-ring binder full of these things. You're trying to figure out who was who and when. And so you actually look at each image and interview it. You ask, when you may. The interesting thing about this picture of Libby is it says maybe it was made in Elgin, Illinois, but it doesn't say when. So you have to ask, when were you made? What format are you in? And there are, I'll be talking about the possible formats in a moment. Where were you made? We know Elgin, Illinois there. Why? We have not a clue. Who? Well, Libby. To answer the question of when, if there is no date, you can look at clothing and hairstyle. And at first I was very doubtful that you could tell things by clothing styles, because look at us, we all, you know, it's hard to tell styles in the 20s. But in the 19th century and 20th century, most of the styles were, people conformed to them. Oddly enough, even people who were immigrating from other countries, they would very, very quickly adopt whatever was in style that year. And if they didn't have much money, they just used cheaper fabrics. So for women in the 1860s, this is my great-great-grandparents' generation, you had these enormous sleeves and enormous dresses, crinolines. And this is what they really looked like. They were in bright colors. Aniline dyes had been invented in 1857. People were crazy about magenta and emerald green and all sorts of other wild colors. But to us, in photographs, they all look black. So we can't tell the colors. Underneath all of these enormous skirts was a cage. A cage was known as a crinoline. And everybody wore them. It's really painful to think about this, but everybody wore them. Even girls, by the age of 12, were wearing them for like Sunday best. Oh, can you see this? How come the lights? I wanted to get rid of all the lights, but I couldn't. You can't see the sleeves in this very well, but her sleeves, down here, they're called bell sleeves. This is a very 1860s thing. This is Civil War era. And this is an older woman of the same era wearing a huge crinoline. She's got a bonnet. That's kind of passé. It's like an 1850s kind of bonnet. But she's an older woman. The women almost always covered their ears in the 1860s. You don't see ears in the early 1860s anyway. They would tie their, make sure their ears were covered, and they had a bonnet in the nape of their neck. It's actually a style feature that works for dating photographs. You can't see her ears. For the guys, just think Abe Lincoln. Civil War, Abe Lincoln, rim beard, no mustache. That was the look. And it wasn't just Abe Lincoln. He was merely an ordinary guy wearing the fashion of the time. So here's a girl with a crinoline. You can see that her no dress would stand out like that without a cage. 1870s. These are dresses from a show that was at the Benton Museum a few years ago, a fashion show of dresses that were donated by Connecticut women of their ancestors' clothes. Very brilliant colors, amazing stitchery. Okay, the crinoline is up, bustle is in. Now you have a flat front skirt and you have big rear end. This is my great-great-grandmother. And you can see that she's wearing a bustle. At first I thought that she just had a big rear end, but no, that's just structure. That's not her. And she's wearing very tight fitted sleeves, unlike those huge bell sleeves that were in during the Civil War. Okay, this is the mid-70s. The Abe Lincoln look is out. Now we've got the big bushy beard. Notice the lots of tousled hair. It was a look. It wasn't just this guy that I thought it was. He wasn't just a radical. Everybody looked that way. This is the same guy we saw in the earlier photo with the rim beard. He's the same man, he just changed his hairstyle because it's a decade later. And here's a guy on George's side of the family. Same hairdo with the ears, and the big bushy beard. Okay, by the late 70s, the big bushy beard is out. We got the mutton chops, the no mustache, and no curly hair over the ears. And this is actually a good dating thing. Look at that, another guy from a different side of the family. He's got the mutton chops, the no curly hair. And there he is with his family. And you can see that the bustle, well, you can't see it well in this light in this photo, but the bustle is gone for a few years, 4 years. If you see a woman with a straight dress and it's got no bustle and no crinoline, it's probably 1878 to 1882. For 4 years, no cages of any sort. They just wore dresses, and even the girls' dresses were like A-line or straightish and slim. And it was sort of a thing to have little girls in these great big lacy collars. And the hair, well, you can see she's got ears. This could not be, this picture could not have been taken in the early 1860s because her ears are showing, she's got no crinoline, he's got the mutton chops. It's an late 1870s picture. In the 80s, you get these really tight bodices, and the crinoline comes, the bustle comes back in. So these are bustle dresses with they have the bodice, I should use this, huh? The bodice with the dropped waist. You can see these dresses have dropped waists, and they're very, very closely fitted, and the sleeves are very closely fitted. Often, these closely fitted sleeves were cut on the bodice, so they were not uncomfortable. You could use your arms in them. But this drape around, the midsection that goes and ties up the big bow in the back, this is 80s. And this is a picture of the 80s bustle. And illustrations of women wearing this thing. It's just a shelf. And then it became suddenly the Noah Mutton Chops. He got the neatly trimmed mustache, if anything. And shirt collars are up. Shirt up very often. Here's another guy, same era. The neat flat hair, no bushing, anything. And a neatly trimmed mustache. And very often they would, suit coats would button right up to here and then do the top button and skip the rest of the buttons. It was a look. Very often would show when you're watching. In the 90s, okay, no more bustles, no more crinolines. Now, the thing has got to be big as your sleeve. The bigger, the better. And there are websites that will tell you exactly how long the leg of mutton was in which year, 91, 92, 93, 94. It kind of migrated up the sleeve. But they were huge, these sleeves. And you can see this lady has a long, droopy sleeve. Like this is about 95. And she has a short, fat sleeve above the elbow. It's a different look, but it's just a different version of the leg of mutton. I think she's wearing a bustle too. And she certainly is. Even factory workers wore those things. In the 90s, very trim look for men, altogether trim. The jacket's buttoned a little lower. This guy's wearing narrow lapels. This guy has wide lapels. I think this is a wedding photo, maybe an engagement photo, but he wants to look his absolute best. And kids just wore white. This actually was true all along. Kids mostly were dressed in white. It was the easiest thing to launder. And we get the little Lord Fauntleroy style. This was very real, and it wasn't just fancy people who went for it. Everybody wanted to have their kids, their little boys, dressed like this. Little boys wore skirts until they wore short pants, and they wore short pants until they wore long pants. The skirts went until about age 5, 4 or 5. Short pants, 8, 9, 10, somewhere in there before they got their first pair of long pants. Got a little ridiculous. These are little girls in front, little boys in back, dressed to look like, I don't know. It's just absurd. 1900s, things begin to simplify a bit. But you got a lot of ribbons and laces. And now, you see belts on women. I don't remember having seen a belt on a woman up to this date. But suddenly you see belts all the time. You see these little hats perched on top of the heads. And the hair was swept up with a bun on top. Ears are showing, but you got this big, like, pumpkin-y thing around your face. This is very much 1900 to 1910, closer, maybe more like 1905 to 1910. And white airy dresses were very much in for women, below, under 30. And nice, clean shave for guys who are still in, maybe with a neat mustache. Now you see, this is a normal, what we consider a normal suit. This first button is down here. It's not up here. We saw this man before. You probably don't recognize him. He's the mutton chop guy. And he was a doctor. I think he may be very close to the end of his life and possibly sick in the 1901 picture. He's lost a lot of flesh in his face, but you can see by the eyebrows. He's the same guy. And children had the white clothes in very fanciful designs in this era. in Europe, big hats for ladies. If you see them, really big, with all kinds of stuff on them, feathers and flowers. This is probably 1910 to 1917 at the latest. As soon as we entered the war, the hats got smaller. But before the war, the hats just got bigger and bigger and bigger. And the corsetry got weirder and weirder. And hair was pulled around the face. And very often you'll see these three-quarter length sleeves with the gloves. Now these are all young people. This is August 1912. This is all vacation time. They're outdoors on vacation time. But the guys, the young men are wearing jackets. Girls are all wearing skirts. And you can't perhaps see it terribly well, but this girl is wearing a great big white bowler on top of her head. That was a 1912 thing. Here's my grandmother in 1912 with her first cousin, who was older, about 15 years. This is a garden party at home. It's a family visit with the gloves, with the big white bowl. Here's a day at the shore. I never can get over how formally people dressed then. They just didn't have what we would call comfortable clothes, period. And we've got a wedding, and you might notice that this gentleman is wearing a very high collar, way up to his chin. And this is a very 1910 to 1915 kind of thing, to wear a high collar. Your tie sits low, and the collar itself is much taller. And there's an example of that tie. You see the tie being low. If you see a round collar like that, or pointed, but if it's pretty high like that, you're talking 1910s. Here's that Belton look. It's coming. This is a wedding in 1917. Every single man is in uniform. War was declared April 6th, 1917. This wedding is in August. All of the men have been in boot camp. They are all shipping out to France within the next 2 months. Every one of them. So you can't really say too much about gentlemen's fashion from this one, but you can see that the ladies' hemlines are up. The bride has, 5 inches from her shoes. Are just naked, or with stockings. And the dresses are not structured. They're just comfortable. Finally, they are seeing a comfortable dress. They're not wearing any particular corsetry. And the hats are still big. You can see these big late bridesmaids' dresses, bridesmaids' hats, garden hats. In the 1920s, the hair changes dramatically. This is my grandmother. You saw her with the poofy hair in 1906 to 1910. I'm guessing that's like 09 or so. And there you see her in 1923. Same person, completely different hairstyle. And things are getting more comfortable. Dresses are mostly calf length and loose. They wear with stockings. Oh, here's a guy he's got a new 20s, neat mustache. He's one who had the Montauk Whiskers back in 77. He was married in 77, and this is a promotional photo he did in 22 for his business. He was an insurance man. But you can see everything about style has changed. His hair is different, his whiskers are different, his tie is different, and you can see the suit. So in the 20s, you see, if you have pictures of kids in your family and they wear these knickerbockers with the tall socks, 20s. Summertime, short pants for kids. And suddenly we have rayon, which means you don't need just cotton, silk, linen, wool anymore. You can have draping clothes. This is really the first time this has been an option. Now we have synthetic clothes. Of course, silk was an option before, but who could afford silk? But everybody could afford rayon. And so we have a whole new style. Dresses like this were cut on the bias, so they were very flattering. But slinky. And in the 40s, suddenly shoulders became big again. see that in, these are all shoulder padded jackets and things. There's a men's look. And for the very first time, you're going to see women in trousers. You wouldn't see it, or only very, very rarely before 1950. Enough of the fashion show. Is that enough? Yeah.
Yeah.
You have to wonder why people took photos. It was never cheap. Even when I was a kid, my mother would get 12 pictures on a roll, and she would use them judiciously from Christmas to Easter. You know, you should only take 12 pictures in 3 months or 4 months. That was because it was expensive to develop a film. So if there's a box in your attic that's old, it meant that someone was paying money, taking time out to dress well for it, show up at the studio, whatever. It was there for a reason. What were the possible reasons? Well, if you see a baby in a beautiful gown, maybe it's a Christmas gown. If you see a young person with a really nice hairdo, like my grandmother with this poofy hairdo, that may have been the first time her mother felt that she should have that grown-up looking hairdo. I don't know about that, but I'm guessing it could be a coming-of-age picture. And I suspect very much that this boy on the left is maybe getting his first real grown-up men's suit and maybe got his first shave. That would be a reason for doing it. Weddings, of course, have always been good reasons for taking photographs. But you can't always tell that they're wedding photographs if the bride isn't wearing white. This is my great-grandparents, Mr. Muttonchop, and his wife in when? You tell me when. Oops, here, go back to that. When was that taken?
1877.
Yes. Did I tell you that already? That's exactly what I was taken.
Oh.
April 26th, 1877. You're good. This is, if you see an older couple all dressed up and looking a little romantic, what do you think that is?
Ambushing.
This is the same people. So now I know, as I did not know for years, that this curly hairline she's got, that's not natural. She had her hair marcelled for her wedding. She had it, you know, artificially waved. She didn't have naturally curly hair. This was more like her real hair. I enjoy little details like that. Well, birthdays and reunions. This lady's holding a little package. I think it's a birthday present. In fact, I updated this one to my grandmother's 50th birthday, because she was born in 1890, and all of her siblings got together with their spouses to celebrate her birthday. Now, here's a class of portrait we don't really have anymore, the morning portrait. Queen Victoria made these quite the big deal when her husband died. She wore morning dress for the rest of her life, and it became the big deal from the 60s, 70s, 80s, 90s, until she died in 1901. Widows wore black, most officially for at least a year and a half. And they very often had their portraits taken. And you can tell a morning photo because there's very little fancy trim on a dress, certainly no shiny trim. If there's any jewelry, it's not shiny. And this looks, you know, it's a very matte surface she's presenting us. And in this case, you can see her father's work jacket. She was one of my Irish people. And her father was a marble worker in Ireland who came to Hartford in 1848. And he died in 77. How can you tell 77? The bustle. I know that he died in 77, but we can also see that she's wearing the bustle and the sleeves and the hair pile on top of the head with the ears showing. All of these details tell me 1877 and her father has just died because of his work jacket. So many portraits. Of course, when people went traveling, they would have their picture taken just to say, I was there. This is my great-great-grandmother visiting Paris in 1895. She was the lady with the enormous leg of mutton sleeves. So then the next question you ask your item, the item in your hand, is, what are you? What kind of thing are you? I've already mentioned daguerreotypes were like 1840 to 60. And you get this possibility of a thing called a tintype. This is my only tintype. These were cheap. And you could get it like a Polaroid. You could go into a studio and get a tintype, but you could also go to a county fair and get a tintype, and they would hand you the picture 3 minutes later. It was instant developing. Not the best quality photos, but very affordable, and many people did them. And since they were available in 1860, many people took these, you know, they hadn't done this before the war, and so they just took tintypes with them. This is just a list. You know what smartphones are the next. Here's a carte de visite. I just showed you a tintype. This is about 1.5 inches by 3 inches. This is a carte de visite. It's basically a visiting card. Everybody had them made. They were calling cards, the way we use business cards. And people collected carte de visite of their friends and their relatives, and especially if they were immigrants, the minute they got here, as soon as they could, they'd get a carte de visite to send back home to show themselves in new American clothing, just as maybe they had their carte de visite taken in the home country just before they left. Because this was worldwide. I've seen carte de visite from Russia and France. People have them from all over the place. It was a very, very popular format, and it lasted for a long time, 30 years or more. And people actually had designed books, photograph albums, just the size of carte de visite, and you could collect them. This is one that was designed by Mark Twain. My cousin owns this, and it has it was published in 1863, published in Philadelphia, and hers is filled with the family members on her side from about that year, carte de visite, from 1860 to 1863. Then came the cabinet card. This is basically the same photographic technique, but as a larger item. You're going to have these probably in your box. They're twice as big, and they're mounted on heavy cardstock, and there are specialists who can tell you exactly what year, what colors of cardstock were current. So you get the gray cardstock, sometimes you get ivory other years, sometimes you get a little pale green, sometimes it's pink, depending on the city, depending on, you know, the photography supply house. But these are very, very nice. They're called cabinet cards because the little guys, you know, they had to go into the photographic albums, and who opens up the albums after the first 2 or 3 days. But a cabinet card you could just mount on a table, on an occasional table in the house, and everybody would see it. You'd see it from a distance. And they were also terribly popular. And some of the people had, in the 1910s, had their pictures taken as postcards. It was just a popular thing. But if you see a postcard on the back of a family photo, you know they just asked to have it done in that format, and the photographer said, sure, we can do that. This is my grandmother's, the one that you know, with her sisters. Well, how do you date these things? So, you know, the carte de visite, it goes from 1860 to 1890, and the cabinet cards, 1870s, how do you date them? Well, if it says on the back, isn't that nice? My great-grandmother was really good about these things. So this is my grandfather in his little Lord Fauntleroy outfit, and he's 2 years and 2 months old. I can date this precisely. So no problem with that. But how about Libby here? We don't know. But we can go online. You can just say, R. W. Dawson, photographer, Eldon, Illinois, and you can learn instantly that he was an active photographer from 1860 to 1885, let's say, I don't know what it was exactly, at various addresses in Eldon. He started out with no address, meaning he was an itinerant photographer, and he would come to your house, or he would, you know, set up shop someplace, but without a permanent address. He actually had a studio opening at Adams Jewelry Store between 1867 and 1874, and then he moved on to another address. And this is all online, because there are fanatics out there who want us to have this information. then I'm very grateful. Very grateful, because it has allowed me to identify, to date a number of things. You just go online with the name of the photographer and you can find out when they were active. So, Libby here, she's got her hair exposed. It's not that over-the-ear thing they had back in the early 60s. And Dawson wasn't working in the early 60s anyway. She isn't wearing a full cage crinoline. She's wearing more triangular crinoline. They became flatter in front by the end of the 60s. And rather relatively fitted sleeves. It must be the late 60s, because it's not the 70s. She's not wearing bustle. It's not the 70s look with the upswept hair. So I'm guessing this is about 1867. Here's another one from that same cousin. See, I don't actually own these cabinet cards or cards to museum. I'm not sure which they are. She just sent me the scans. But this one has my cousin Rosalind's handwriting again, saying that this is done by the Kellogg brothers photographers, 275 Main Street, Hartford, Connecticut. And 1845 to 1920 means when this young man lived. He was born in 45 and died in 1920. But we still, well, you can guess pretty well when this was done, right? In fact, the Kellogg brothers were at 275 Main Street, 1860 to 61. That's the only time they were there. So this is not later in the war, this is not 63, this is not 64, this is not 65. It is 61, and he looks his age, which is a mere 16 years old. He does not look happy, but maybe he does. Here's another cabinet card. This is not an old lady. The whole era of photographers, all photography had only become available to her in her older age. And she had her portrait done, I think a morning portrait. I think her husband has died at this point. She's wearing a widow's cap. She had done by Dudley Kirk's. And he was in Madison Square Garden. It says right on there somewhere. Oh, here it is. Madison Square, the old Madison Square. He was there in 1873 and afterwards. That means this picture was taken after 1873. Her husband died sometime between 1870 and 1880 because he just disappears from the census. It may be a morning portrait. She was born in 1811, so she's at least 62 here, and I am guessing older. But I can say this is for sure. This is in the 1870s because of Kurtz's acting. Okay, that's it for cabinet cards. That's it for the carte de visite. That's it for tintypes. Now we're into the age of senior snapshots. Everybody could do home photography after 1898. 97 in this case. These were early adopters. But after 98, everybody could do it. Before that, you were really dependent on a professional. You had to go to a studio, or at least go to a county fair and find an itinerant photographer. But now, we could get a pocket camera. And many people did. Oh, I'm not boring you with all this. It's all information about it. You can find it online. But basically, it was an affordable thing. And the color snapshots first became available in 35. You're not likely to have color snapshots from 35 because it was very expensive. I had an uncle who was a real techie and early adopter type. But mostly it's black and white or sepia until. And you have studio pictures. When you take your kid to the studio and they take pictures, you will find these in your boxes. And sometimes, not always, but very often they are signed by. Photographer, and that helps. Sometimes a photo is not a photo. It's really a photo of something else, or something else. This is the original photograph. Photograph here, the other photograph here, you might find they were derivatives of photos. And here's a photograph of a daguerreotype. If you're lucky enough to have one of those, it's probably better than the daguerreotype itself. Okay, I'm going to tell you a couple of stories, if you're good for them. Are we getting restless?
No.
Okay, so just a couple of stories. One shows you know, how I go about solving mysteries. None of it actually tells a story. This is something I found in my mother's farm. It's in daguerreotype, and I don't know who it is. I take it out of the frame, which you're not supposed to do. I want to know who this is. I'm rather desperate. I should have taken it to someone who specializes in these things, but I didn't. Took it out of the frame, scanned it. Now I can close up on the scan. I can see this person's face. I want to know who she is. By now, by this time in my research, I have identified most of my great-great-grandparents. I know that this is a daguerreotype, which means it's got to be 1840 to 1860, which means that she is probably not a great-great-grandparent. She's a probably a triple great. Is that right? No, because she's so young, she might be one of the great greats in youth. That's it, before she gets married. Well, I know who that guy is. Do they look related? He got married in 1877. This could be his mother, because, you know, he's the photography, she's the daguerreotype. She could be his mother if I'm right, but I don't know how to be right. Boy, did I suffer over this one. To me, there's a resemblance. One of this is a daguerreotype, the other is a photo. There's no way you could even get them side by side in real life. But scanning them, you can get the images side by side. You can really compare them. The intensity in the eyes, the very wide mouth. You can't tell her ears. He's got really sticky out of ears. But I just had this funny feeling they were related. And I had identified one of the other great greats. So by process of elimination, didn't have his mother. And I started looking for his mother. I knew his name. I didn't know his mother's name. My mother probably didn't know it either. She talked about the grandmother that was Irish, but she never mentioned the name. Not one of my siblings ever heard her say that name. So I knew his name, Cornelius C. Cook. And I did Ancestry.com and I realized, oops, there were several sort of Cornelius C. Cooks in upwards of New York State about the same time. Which one? Well, I got on it on Wild Goose Chase and chose the wrong one for a while and did the whole family tree for these people that I'm not related to. But then I found his marriage certificate, which is why I know it's April 26, 1877. I found his marriage certificate, and it says that his mother is Mary Trumbull and his father is John Thomas Cook. Okay, now I'm on it. I know that the person I'm looking for is Mary Trumbull, right? So I look. I'm having trouble finding this person. And so I don't know what to do, so I reach out to my cousins. This actually is a couple of years between these steps. And I tell them I'm looking for this person called Mary Trumbull, and I'm wondering if this person is Mary Trumbull. And a cousin sends this. It says on the back, given to Harold, CCC, that's Cornelius C. Cook, Grandma Cook, and Lita. It looks like Lita, but it really is Lita. I don't know because I know what her name was. This is the christening photo we saw earlier. This is 1869. He was born in 1869. Is it possible that this is the same one? So I do the same thing. I'm working now from a daguerreotype to a tintype. The daguerreotype was big. This is the tintype. But I can make them the same size. I can zero in on them. And I can work with the color in iPhoto. So I put them side by side and I say, well, cousins, what do you think? Is it the same person? Look at the intensity of the eyes and the wide mouth in both. And very, I find this cheekbone really convincing. The cheekbone and the chin line, really strong chin in both. She's looking down in the older photograph. And you can see that those eyebrows have been deepened. Her eyes have become deeper, but I think it's the same one. I call her Mary. You can find all sorts of stories of wedding photos. To tell the story, of course you've got to date everything, you've got to label everything, all of that, but there's more to it than just that. Make timelines. Once you've got a photo, you can say, and you know when it was made, you can say, okay, this photo is, let's say, 1868. What was happening then in history? what was happening with the history of the family, who was born, who was dying, who was traveling, who was doing what. And if you use other techniques like ancestry.com and newspapers.com and family search, you can create a timeline about when things happened and begin to make sense of it. So back to Libby. This will be the story of Libby and then we'll be done. So we know we've got the picture. Libby and Ellen. This is an unidentified woman, but she's also photographed by R.W. Dawson in Eldon. And it's got a prominent name on it, but nobody knows who she is. Same young woman in Worcester. Exactly the same face. Now she's in Worcester. How about that? There's a mystery. Now we've got two women in Worcester. Same photographer that we just saw. One of them is clearly unidentified person, and I will say that the one on the right is Libby, with her hair covered. It's earlier, an earlier hairstyle with the same crinoline. So it's from the 1860s. Both of these young ladies are having their pictures taken in crinolines. Oh, there is even a way to date this particular look with a sleeve. I think it's up 1867. So we got Libby. There she's in Eldon, and there she is in Massachusetts. Obviously the same person. What's going on? Well, here's what I found. I'm a Crompton, obviously. My great-great-great-grandfather, William Crompton, emigrated from England in 1836, originally brought his family in 39, and all of his brothers and sisters, seven of them, all followed suit within the next few years. So this is one of his youngest brothers. He came about 1844. He had married just before he came over. And he started out in Worcester, living probably with my great-great-great-grandfather. But he moved west. He had his first child in Worcester and his second child in Ohio. And he made it out to Racine, Wisconsin. And he had two daughters, Mary Jane and Elizabeth Ellen. I've been able to construct a timeline for Mary Jane and Elizabeth. Elizabeth is Libby, I am absolutely certain. They were, you know, when they were born, where they were living, this is just based on census data. And the census somehow I found out through Ancestry that Mary Jane married George Jackson in 1871. There's no question in my mind that Mary Jane is the lady on the left. And her sister is Libby. So Mary Jane married, and her father Ralph died the following year. Her husband, George W. Jackson, was a Civil War vet. He had recently lost his wife and had a bunch of kids already. He was 12 years older than Mary Jane. He had like five kids already. And for reasons I have not delved into, he got some land in Maryland and became a farmer. And he moved his wife, his wife's sister, his wife's mother, all of his kids from the former marriage to this farm in Maryland. And in 1884, Mary Jane had her only child, Cora. The census tells me that by 1900, Mary and her mother were both dead. I don't know if she died of childbirth or of consumption or what. I just don't know, but I could find out. By 1910, George had died and the kids had moved away. Who did that leave? That meant Elizabeth, that Libby, and maybe a young Cora. I'm not sure what's going on with Cora at this point. 1920 census shows Libby, age 71, living in Windsor, Connecticut. Now I'll be able to tell my story. My story is that in 1867, when they were living in Racine, the two sisters traveled east to meet all their first cousins, who all lived in the Worcester and Connecticut area. Some of them were in Worcester, some of them were Connecticut. I think they had a great big family reunion to celebrate a family event in 67, and that they met all their first cousins that summer. They'd never seen them again, but they kept in touch. The reason I know they kept in touch is that in this house in Windsor, there were cousins from three of the Crompton men who moved here in the 1830s and 40s. They were all first cousins, and they were taking care of each other in old age. They had one 22-year-old Polish woman taking care of these old folks in the Worcester House. I mean, in the Windsor House. By, you know, the most, she was the youngest. Olivia's the youngest. Everybody else is dead by 1930. Where is she? I found out this morning. I was going to stop the story there to say, isn't this a lovely story of family caring for each other before Social Security? Because that's all it really is. These were all unmarried people, by the way. Catherine never married, William Henry never married, Mary never married, and William never married. And that's part of the legacy of the Civil War. It's hard for a young woman to get married at the Civil War, because there were no men. Just this morning, I found Libby in the 1930 census, and she was in Middletown. And who else is in the census with her? She's in a house. There's like a private hospital. And her niece, Cora Jackson, is the general manager of this house for elderly people. There's a nurse, and there are a bunch of 70 and 80-year-olds. This house is now, I Googled the house, the address, the exact address. And it's now the Interfaith Center for Wesleyan. To me, that's an incredible story. She kept in touch with everybody. And they, you know, in the course of her life, everybody dies, and finally she's left with her niece. It's her story. To me, it's a wonderful story. It's not mine, I mean, it's just someone related to me. So now I'm going to wrap this up with just a few suggestions. Yes?
So, for different family members, do you have it on your computer to say for your daughter or whatever, with the picture and the data? Is that how you do it? Or
this is what I'm getting to.
For this, but
this is what I'm getting to. I print everything out, and I print it out on my own computer.
Yep, and
back to the front.
Data?
And all the data, I handwrite stuff myself on these things.
Okay, but you don't print out all of them?
No,
you
I can't.
Have
I can't.
Oh,
this is the cheapest
that.
Thing you can do. It's just print things right out of your computer, put it in a 3D reminder. This probably cost me 85 cents, right? But it's nice. You can really look at things. The next most expensive thing you can do is do the same thing in color. Take it to Staples. Well, this isn't actually color. This is black and white, so it's on better paper. This cost me 10 bucks.
Do you like writing on
it? Yes, I did this in iPhoto. And in this book, I wrote everybody, these are all couples. I started with the triple breaks, I think, in this book, and came down to the present. But my idea is that this is a couple, and their son married their daughter. And it says at the bottom of the page, to find their son and their daughter, turn the page blah, blah, blah. In this case, you have to turn to page 33, and then you see in the next generation, what happened to them, who they married. So that's like that's a cheap option. $10, you can afford to make a few of that for your family. Here's what I do, the laborious option. I make books with lots of text, census data, all the photos that I have access to. And then when I'm, you know, at the back, I put, if I have it, do I have it for this book? No, for some of the books, I have them in the back of the room, you can look at them. I have all the ancestry names going all the way back. This is the promptings, and I don't have much on them. Oh, I know, I did one little thing on them in the front of this. I just give all the information I possibly can put in one place so that I can share it with everybody. Make copies of the book, and everybody can get a box of stuff. The end.
Where do you get that one? How do you
print that one?
I do this through My Canvas. It's a service. It's an online service. I just want to make sure.
Thank you.
It's an online service that allows you to do text and photos equally well. Most of these, like Shutterfly and things like that, allow you to do photos really well, but the text part isn't so great. You don't have a lot of choices and sizes and fonts, or, and and they tell you where you have to put the text, and they won't let you put any more than they want. This, I can make every single page custom in terms of sizes and shapes of text boxes and photo boxes. It's not the cheap. It's not the cheap option. It's expensive, but it's good, and the paper is marvelous.
Something sort of halfway, you know, like Dorothy was alluding to that. I did some work like that on my family photos, and it was very nice. And what I did is I got them digitized, and then I put them on the computer, and I put them on a CD at that time. But what I ran into was the problem with narrative, you know, and what to do and how to work that.
Right.
The only way I could figure out to do that was to just have that separate and try to key it with the photos,
There's another way is to do it in Word, and you can import pictures into Word. And then you can make a PDF of the whole big document and send it to people using Dropbox. That is another free option.
Yeah.
It's very labor intensive. It'll take you hours and hours, but it doesn't cost a thing.
Mm-hmm.
And then they can decide to take that statement if they want and have it printed and pay for it.
There are other software.
And Karen can probably tell us about other things that have good text.
Yeah, there are other software options. There's a software that you purchase called Historian, and it allows you to organize your photos and write the stories and descriptions attached to each photo.
Uh-huh.
And then you can send them to this company called Forever to print. Or the other option with Forever is they have an online digital vault, photo vault.
Mm-hmm.
That's secure and permanent and private. And with that, you can also give access to friends and family. And you can put the photos and start your stories, and they can add to the story.
Oh, wow.
All that.
Fabulous.
So, I mean, that's a digital option.
Yep.
It's in the cloud, but then again, they have the option where you can take that information and put it into books and curriculums.
Yeah. Paper is ultimately your safest bet.
Yeah.
Don't count on anything staying in the cloud for the next generation. Don't count on your computer working for the generation. Get it printed out however you can. Because we still have Gutenberg Bibles. You know, paper really lasts.
Actually, I listened to a webinar like 5 or 6 years ago from this gentleman from the Library of Congress. And that's exactly what he said. He said, yes, you can digitize things as backup because, God forbid, there's an emergency.
Sure.
That's the fastest way to get them out of your house.
Right.
But if you have, like you say, the printed copies of photos have lasted over 100 years.
Yeah.
And, print, even if you make a book, print the book, but then you also have a digital version of the book that you can carry out in an emergency.
Having multiple copies of the same information is really ideal. It means more people can enjoy it in generations to come. And I say this is informational estate planning. And if you get other people involved, it may bring you closer to relatives and heal old rifts that happened in previous generations, and who cares anymore? I have met a lot of first, second, and third cousins I didn't even know through doing this project. And now, I came back just a few weeks ago from a visit of the cousins in Florida. We've been doing this for the past few years, and it's been wonderful. Because we all have memories of kind of the same stuff, but through different voices. We can tell the stories from different slants. And it's just fun to be together. So, this really is.